Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Smith Grove Baptist Church. My name is Nathaniel Kriebel. I'm the worship director here. It's good to be back this week. Missed you all last week, but I know you were in good hands. I just wanted to share, I was with one of our college worship teams in Kentucky. We were serving at a school there, and God was doing some really neat things among the students there. Both nights we had some extended times of response with them. We extended the worship time because they were responding to what God was doing. So thanks for the opportunity to be part of that, but I know you are in good hands here, and it is good to be back with you today. I just want to say one thing before we start. If you're visiting or if you have anything you need to share with the office, there are those blue Connect cards in the chairs in front of you. Some of them have a QR code you can scan and do digitally, or you can fill it out, and that can just go in the offering plate, which is you can turn it in during the offering time or by the back door. That just gives us a record of your attendance with us, and if you have anything you need to share with us, we will receive that and respond to you if that's what you're needing. Okay, we're going to begin our time of worship. Last week, I missed the sermon on victory in Christ, but we're going to start there today, so let's stand together. We're going to sing Victory in Jesus in just a moment, but first, Psalm 107 tells us, and this is our call on us today, to give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His faithful love endures forever. Has the Lord redeemed you? Well, then speak out and tell others he has redeemed you from your enemies, for he has gathered exiles from many lands, and that includes us. We are brought into his family today. Let's celebrate that together.
Precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me.
Forever, he sought me and bought me.
Shout your praises loud. I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love come down. I will sing forever of your love come down. With my hands to heaven, shout your praises loud. I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love come down.
Lord, some praise today. Let's continue to story what God has done.
As in the darkness we were waiting without hope and without light, till from heaven you came running and there was mercy. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit. Suffering, you saw to the other side. knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you died. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise for you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to our Father are restored. Declare this, the church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lived. The flame, now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint, for by his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free, for the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy.
All praise to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy, He has given us a new birth. And now we are children of God. That is who we are. Let's delight ourselves in this truth this morning.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome? Lost, but He brought me, oh, His love for me, oh, His love for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child. His grace runs deep.
Thank you, Lord.
Though while I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, He died for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child. Yes, I am.
Father, we ask that as we continue in our worship through hearing your word that speaks to this freedom that you've set us free for, that you would help us to walk in it, to not stand far off, to not think that maybe one day I'll be free, but to even now rest in our status as children of God and to walk in the fullness of all of your plans for us. Lord, help us in this today. We pray that your spirit would work in us, would give us that even deeper assurance that we belong to you and that you will not let us go. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated.
Good morning. I want to welcome you as well, say thank you for being here with us. Before we get to the sermon, if you hadn't heard, Jess Thompson was taken to the ER this morning. He had a nosebleed that they couldn't get under control. He is back home now, so be praying for them as he recovers, and I know he's got a checkup this week to check everything out. So be lifting Jess and Donna up if you would. We miss them being with us this morning. He was supposed to play drums this morning, and Micah stepped in, so we want to thank him, too, for stepping up and stepping in when that was a need. But be praying for them, if you would, and we'll try to keep you posted on that if we hear anything. The last few weeks, I've had the opportunity to take some pictures at some of the track meets here in town. And I don't know if you've ever gone to a track meet and watched them run these races, but my favorite ones to watch are the long-distance ones. Because you know, as a young kid, most of these kids are really quick. I mean, they like shoot down, like the 100-meter dash takes no time at all. But when they have to run the track like three or four times, I'm like, wow, look at them go. And one of the things I've noticed is the kids that maybe aren't as seasoned in their running, like they take off when the gun goes off, and they are like shooting around that track for the first lap. By the fourth lap, though, they're kind of lagging behind. They've used all their energy up, and I've seen a couple come across the finish line and collapse and go, I'm never going to do that again. And I'm like, that is me, buddy, that is me. I don't even have to run a lap, and I know I'm not doing it again. But there's others, though. You can tell they're a little more seasoned. They've trained. They've prepared for it. They get that they don't want to bust out of the gate with all their energy. It's even more noticeable when you watch little kids. Have you ever seen like a fun run at a 5K? I know we're a big church of 5Kers, but amen. But they usually have like a kid's little run, and to watch those kids again, they just take off full force, and they get about 100 feet, and they're like, oh, and then they kind of like have to walk past the finish line, right? They're not prepared. They've not put in the time. They've not paced themselves. They're not able to go the distance. And when we think about those kids that can't go the distance, we might look at them as the Galatians. Paul illustrates their failure to go the distance. In fact, you're going to hear him say today, you were running well. You were doing a good job. But who prevented you from obeying the truth? What changed? Why couldn't you go the distance? The Galatians, they started out terrifically, but they were not persevering to the end. You even look in Hebrews, and the author there compares the Christian life to a race. He urges readers to run with endurance the race that lies before us. He also notes that weight and sin can hinder us from finishing the race. What else can keep us from enduring? The Galatians show us false teaching can prevent us from finishing, can prevent us from enduring. The Galatians had failed to understand how you live the Christian life once you begin it. They started off strong, and then it just kind of petered out. They heard these false teachings, and they started to be led astray. And I don't think this is an issue only for them, though. I think in the modern church, it can also, we can expect new believers to know what to do. We can expect them to find their own way. We expect them to pick up the Christian life after they've been saved and just go great guns, and we don't even take the time to show them. It's hard to live the Christian life if we're not prepared, if we don't have people checking on us. We need to support one another. We need to disciple one another. We need to explain the basics of a life in Christ. For the Galatians, particularly, they failed to understand Christian freedom. They were not living as freed captives, but they were living as slaves once again. And it happened because here they were listening to these teachers who were saying things contrary to what Paul had taught, what they had believed when Paul was with them. And so chapter 5, we get this look at the freedom that Jesus has brought us. And we see some instructions for running or living in the freedom of Christ. And this morning we're going to look at the first one, which is that we're to live free. He has saved us. He has brought us from sin, from death to life, and we are to live free. So we're going to read the first part of Galatians chapter 5. We're going to start in verse 1, and we're going to read through verse 15. Here's what it says. For freedom, Christ sets us free. Stand firm then, and don't submit again to a yoke of slavery. Take note, I, Paul, am telling you that if you get yourself circumcised, Christ will not benefit you at all. Again, I testify to every man who gets himself circumcised that he is obligated to do the entire law. You who are trying to be justified by the law are alienated from Christ. You have fallen from grace, for we eagerly await through the Spirit by faith the hope of righteousness. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision accomplishes anything. What matters is faith working through love. You are running well. Who prevented you from being persuaded regarding the truth? This persuasion does not come from the one who calls you. A little leaven leavens the whole batch of dough. I myself am persuaded in the Lord. You will not accept any other view. But whoever it is that is confusing you will pay the penalty. Now, brothers and sisters, if I still preach circumcision, why am I still persecuted? In that case, the offense of the cross has been abolished. I wish those who are disturbing you might also let themselves be mutilated. For you were called to be free. Brothers and sisters, only don't use this freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but serve one another through love. For the whole law is fulfilled in one statement, love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out, or you will be consumed by one another. Now, there's a lot here. We're gonna focus on verse 1, and that's it. That's where we're staying today, is the very first verse, because that's really the summary of these last two books in this chapter, or these last two chapters in this book, rather. Paul tells us that we have this profound freedom in Christ. Paul's initial sentence is even stronger and more definitive in Greek than how it comes across in English. Now, don't be fooled. I don't know Greek, all right? I've not studied it. But in my research, I came across this gentleman that does know Greek, I would assume, because he's writing about it. But listen to what this says. Both the noun and the verb in this sentence are the word freedom. Freedom is both the means and the end of the Christian life. He literally says, Paul literally says, for freedom, Christ freed you. For freedom, he freed you. Everything about the Christian gospel is freedom. Jesus' whole mission was an operation of liberation. And the verb translated has set us free, refers to a single past action that is now completed. It's done. He's already set us free. We are free. Oh my goodness, that's good news, right? That's exciting, the fact that we are free, and it doesn't have to be done again. So in the most definitive way, Paul tells us that that Christians have been set free, but then he warns us that the freedom we have in the gospel can be lost. Now hear me, I'm not saying we can lose our salvation, but I'm saying this freedom that we've gained through the gospel can kind of shift to the side, can kind of get out of the way, can be lost by us. Paul says that despite its divine source, our freedom is fragile. It can slip from our grasp. I'm sure most of us can probably testify to this happening in our lives. We move from living free to we hear something that sounds truthful, that maybe is a little off from maybe we were raised a certain way. We're like, oh my goodness, maybe this is true. And we kind of veer off the path where Jesus is it, and we know that it's him, and we start to live a little bit different. We try to check boxes. It happens to us so easily. And when that does, we move from freedom and we move back to slavery. We move back to these shackles of sin. It can happen if we lose sight of Christ and what he has done. And we slip back into this self-reliance that we can sometimes use to walk through this life. It's part of our humanness. It's part of living in a fallen world. But we know if we just rely on the Spirit to guide us and keep us focused on Christ, we can live in this true freedom that Christ has given us. And so this morning, we focus in on this verse that calls us to live free. Listen to it once more. For freedom, Christ set us free. Stand firm then, and don't submit again to a yoke of slavery. Paul begins by saying, Christ has liberated us to be free. This first verse, it should be considered one of the key verses in this book. Paul wants his readers to live free. Christ has saved them to be free. And in that freedom, they're called to live in a different way. Now, this sentence, it also functions as the transition verse between the last section and what follows. And we've spent some time in the first part of this book, but Paul just discussed freedom. 3 weeks ago, we were talking about this. He calls them out from living as slaves. He says, you're not slaves anymore, you're sons. He says, you're sons of the Father. No more are you slaves. They were resorting to slavery to idols, to slavery to the law, to slavery to these elemental forces. Paul illustrated this idea with the Isaac and Ishmael. Remember, we went over that a few weeks ago? He was teaching them that Christians are children of the free. They're children of promise. They're children's walking. They're walking miracles. They're born of the Spirit, and they are not children of slavery anymore. In light of all this, Paul says, don't submit to it then. Don't submit to slavery. And what follows is this exhortation, and there's more on that subject, but before we see it, if you go back to verse 13, Paul says this. He says, for we're called to be free brothers. He says, we're doing this together. We're free together. You don't walk this alone. You don't have to do this alone. We are brothers in this. Because Christ has liberated us to be free, rest and rejoice in him. That's where you find it. We should rejoice in Christ because we've come to our final resting place. He's with us always. We're not under condemnation. We don't have to be enslaved to idols. The Exodus is this beautiful picture of how Christ has delivered us. Jesus liberated us not from Egypt, though, but from sin's awful slavery. And he's brought us into his kingdom. No longer slaves, we're sons. Jesus says in John chapter 8, he says, a slave does not remain in the household forever, but a son does remain forever. So if the son sets you free, you really will be free. If you know this, if this is truth to you, if you know this as truth, but you're not glorifying Christ deeply because of it, it raises this question of why not? And one of the answers is we have to have forgotten how terrible slavery was. Go back to the Israelites. Remember, they were in slavery. And once they escaped and they're wandering in the desert, what did they want back? Well, let's just go back to Egypt. They'll take care of us. I mean, it wasn't so bad, was it? They wanted to go back. The gospel is not awesome unless you see the awfulness of your previous condition. I know we don't like to talk about sin. We don't like to talk about our past. But we have to realize how awful it is before we know him so we understand how amazing he is now. But there was one theologian put it this way. He said, till sin be bitter, Christ will never be sweet. Did you catch that? Until sin is bitter to us, until we see sin for what it is, call it out for what it is, turn from it like we should, Christ isn't going to be sweet. We need to understand what Christ has done in order to adore him and not return to the way it was before, not return to that bondage, that slavery that we were in. To understand freedom, think about it like this. As believers, we are freed objectively. We are freed technically or legally from the guilt of sin. But we struggle to be free subjectively. Through our experiences, through our daily life, we struggle to be free from the grip of sin. Another author wrote about this. He said, the whole book of Galatians is about people who, from what we can tell, were objectively freed from guilt. But they were going back into a form of works righteousness. Why? He says, this is a little bit of speculation, but as a pastor over the years and as a human being, I think that deep down inside, maybe it's because of the image of God. Interesting. I mean, everyone knows he or she should be perfect, he says, but we all know we should be perfect, but we know that we can't. And so we start to look for ways we can do things. We can make it that way. The truth is, though, we can't do this in our own power. And we slip away from this reliance of God to reliance on self, and we lose sight and we lose this gospel freedom that we have. We don't have to be slaves to any of this stuff. Objectively, we know this truth. Look at what it's stated in Romans 8. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus, because the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. If you know this, if you believe this, say amen. Wow, man. You all like to have no condemnation and freedom. I can tell. That was vibrant. Right? This is what we have now. If we know this in our head, if we know this in our heart, we can live in a whole nother way. We are free from the penalty of sin. How many of you know what the penalty of sin is? You can say it out loud. It's okay. Eternal separation from God, death. The consequences of sin are great. We don't have it anymore. There's no condemnation. We've been set free from the penalty. That's justification, right? We don't have to live with this sense of being unacceptable to God. Christ has made us acceptable. Christ alone is perfect, and we've got to rest in his perfect work performed on our behalf. We can't revert to works-based righteousness. Subjectively or experientially, we need to learn how to live free from the power of sin. That's sanctification. Sanctification is simply the art of getting used to our justification. We're free, but we don't always live free. We don't always live like he's called us to. We are in need of becoming what we already are. We're a new creation. We are changed. We are alive in Christ, and yet so often we live as though we're not. We live in the exact opposite of where he's brought us to. It's sanctification, living as a free, justified person, resting in Christ alone. We wrestle with our old idols that continue to tempt. We wrestle with the guilt of the law, which tries to condemn us. But we have to keep coming back to the gospel and get used to our justification. I keep telling you, the gospel should stir something else. We should be preaching the gospel to each other all the time. Yeah, we talk about taking it out of here, but we need it as well. It needs to be buried deep down into our hearts so we understand this so much more fully. Christ has made us righteous. Do you believe you're free objectively from condemnation? Do you believe that with all your heart, that you are objectively free from condemnation? Do you believe that you're accepted in Christ perfectly? Subjectively, are you living out that new identity and not reverting to idols of slavery or to religion? Objectively, the Galatians were not walking in this truth. They believed that they needed to contribute to their final salvation. They were basically practicing self-atonement by believing that the gospel was Jesus plus something else. They said there's more to it than just Jesus, that you've got to get circumcised, you've got to follow the law. And Paul says, no, you don't. He says, you're stepping back into slavery. Stay away from it. Don't pick that yoke back up. The good news is that you stand accepted today in Christ if you've accepted him. Nothing we do is going to make us more or less accepted by him. Please hear that. You cannot earn salvation. You cannot earn his favor. It is there. If we are in Christ, that is liberty. Paul opens this book with this statement about freedom. He says that Christ gave himself for our sins to rescue us from this present evil age. He came to deliver us from the grip of this age, the flesh, the elemental spirits, idolatry, and the evil one. Just as Israel got out of Egypt objectively, but had this slavishness in their hearts, we also wrestle with believing and living in our freedom. And when this happens, We take our eyes off of Christ and our worship becomes hindered. When we stop adoring Christ, when we stop adoring our Redeemer, we will not grow spiritually. Growth happens as we continue to focus on the glory of Christ, the one who has made us righteous. However, there's a lot of Christians that suffer from this condition where we know this, but we don't. When we know that we've been saved from slavery to sin and that we should be free, and if we really believed in our hearts what we know with our heads, then we would not still be a slave in our hearts to success or to what other people think. Technically and objectively, we are not slaves, but God has freed us from sins that we were enslaved to. God has freed you from the things to which you are still enslaved at this point. You have to work the gospel down deep in order to run in this freedom that is yours. We've got to understand the gospel. We've got to get it down. We've got to know it. We've got to recite it. We've got to teach it. We've got to share it. Know it in a way that it impacts your life so you can live free like he's calling us to. Paul goes on, though, and not only does he say that Christ has liberated us to be free, but because he's done this, we need to stand firm in him. Stand firm in Christ. There's an interesting parallel here with political freedom. It's well observed fact that it takes vigilance and responsibility for a nation or a group of people to maintain their political independence. And Paul says this is just as true in regard to spiritual freedom. Free believers need to stand firm in their freedom. To stand firm is really this military word that mixes together the ideas of keeping alert or being strong and resisting attack and sticking together. We're to stand firm together in our freedom. Stand firm, watching to make sure it's not taken from us, being strong so that it doesn't get ripped from us or we don't shy away from it. In short, despite the fact that we've already been saved by Christ, we've got to continually be diligent to remember and persevere and rejoice in and live in accord with our salvation. We cannot lose our salvation, but we can lose our freedom from enslavement to fear. We can go back to that point where fear is what we become a slave to. Paul says that standing firm in freedom will safeguard us against submitting to legal bondage. And in verse 13, he adds that it will be a safeguard against danger for the opposite direction, namely the abuse of freedom or indulging the flesh. He's saying, keep it between the guardrails. Keep it on the straight and narrow. Make sure that Christ is the one in front of you. That's what you're focused on. It's all in him. He adds in verse 1, don't submit again to a yoke of slavery as well. He says, you've been freed. Stand firm and don't put this yoke back on. You've had it before. Don't do it again. Now, the yoke probably refers to this false teaching. That is saying that they're not free and that they need to keep the law. To submit to circumcision and adopt the Old Testament law as a means of salvation, that is slavery. That's not living in freedom. They effectively put themselves in Ishmael's family instead of Isaac's family. They said, here, we're making a choice, and it's not the good one, because the gospel frees us from condemnation. So do not put on that yoke that says you're not free in Christ. Once more, this is not unique to the Galatians. It's something we as believers struggle with today. Have you ever placed something at God's feet and said, here, I want you to have this, and then, you know, 3 days later, you pick it back up and say, wait a minute, I'm not done. I can fix this. Let me take it. Let me handle it. Right? We struggle with this today. We take back the things that we've given to God. We try to do them in our own power. We end up becoming legalistic and checking off boxes or hypocritical. We at times may even embrace these false teachings that have been presented. A real test for believers is whether or not we act like a Pharisee or we act like Paul. Jesus said that Pharisees end up tying up these heavy loads with their lists of rules, and they put a yoke on the hearers. Listen to how it's put in Matthew 23. They tie up heavy loads that are hard to carry and put them on people's shoulders, but they themselves aren't willing to lift a finger to move them. Here these men are teaching the law. They're saying, this is how it has to be. You got to follow every letter of the law. They're putting this burden on their listeners with their words, and then they don't offer any help. They don't offer any guidance to see them succeed. They place these unrealistic expectations on them and didn't provide freedom at all. It keeps them enslaved. That kind of teaching, you know what that does? It crushes people. It's lifeless. It doesn't offer any hope. It doesn't offer any security. And this type of law-keeping religion is really slavery. And it was common in Judaism of the time to talk about taking on the study and practice of the whole law of Moses as coming under the yoke. Both Christ and the early church saw the Pharisees and the teachers of the law enslaving people with this yoke, saying, you're not free. You've got to do this, this, and this. And the Galatians were in danger of going under this yoke as well. But the startling word in the sentence is the word again. It wasn't the first time they'd been in this place. The Galatian believers had been pagans, and they were under the slavery of literal idolatry. But here Paul once more makes this radical claim that this pagan idolatry and biblical moralism are basically the same thing. These both boil down to the same spiritual slavery. Under circumcision, the Galatians would experience once again this anxiety, this guilt, this burdened life that they knew as pagans. That wasn't freedom in Christ. They were going back to their old ways. They would never be sure if they were being good enough. Their lives would be as fear-based and proud and guilt-ridden as they were before. In fact, probably more so. Because they had experienced freedom in Christ. They would fall to insecurity and pride. They would fall to discouragement and weariness of people who were never sure they were worth enough. Never sure they'd done enough. What a sad place to be. But it happened then and it still happens now. Paul, on the other hand, he takes people to Christ. He points them to true freedom. knowing that it's not about what they can do or what they've done, but what Christ has done, what he's provided. In Christ, we find our peace, we find our liberty, we find our joy, we find our security. Parents, as you look at raising your children, do you take them to Mount Sinai's laws and leave them there? Or are you taking them from there and going to Calvary for grace? We need to point children that way, but we also every person needs to be pointed that way. Each other, we need to point each other to the liberator and the redeemer. The default mode of the heart is self-justification. Every person is a Pharisee in the making. But we've got to teach one another the gospel, which it's counterintuitive. We've got to say to one another, you can't, but Jesus did. It's done for you. Give them grace. Give them Galatians. Let them read through it. Read through it with them. Let them see what Paul's saying here. Now, there's some who think that if you teach freedom in Christ, no one will want to serve him. That's not true. The opposite actually happens. When you recognize all that Christ has done and you truly work this into your heart, you're going to adore Christ. You're going to understand why you want to do these things for him. And an adoring heart, it does not lead a sinful life. It leads a holy life. Some fear that grace delivered, blood bought, radical freedom will result in this loveless license. But redeeming, unconditional love alone, not fear, not guilt, not shame, this unconditional love alone carries the power to compel heartfelt loyalty to the one who bought us. After all, where that yoke of the Pharisees led back to slavery, consider the yoke of Christ. Look at what it says in Matthew 11. He says, come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, because I am lowly and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Is that not much better? Is that not much greater? The comfort and the peace and the freedom we have in that. Which yoke would you rather have on you? That of the Pharisees and false teachers, or that of God? See, Christ has freed us through his atoning work. It is a glorious freedom. His freedom should lead us just to rest in him and rejoice in him. His freedom should cause us to do what he wants, and that is not submit to this yoke of slavery. God calls us to live in freedom. He saves us to be free. Yet at times we walk away from this gospel freedom and we walk right back into slavery. If you're there, don't think you're alone, because you're not. As we prepare to close this morning, our time of response, we're going to give you some time just to quiet your heart. Just to do kind of an inventory of where you're at. Is there sin that's in your life that you need to really just hand over to him and let him have it? Do you need to feel the weight of his yoke? Do you need to find rest there? Then do it. We're already free. He's already accomplished it. It's us that pick it back up. It's us that take it back with us. We know we're free, but we're not living like it. We walk away from that freedom and we go into the shackles we once knew so well. If that's you this morning, don't walk out of here that same way. Lay the weight down. Lay the sin down. Understand that what Paul is preaching here is truth. We can't do any of it, but Jesus did it. So as we take this time, we're gonna sing softly and tenderly. You know that song? He calls us to come home. If you're weary, if you're burdened, come home. It's going to be open up here. Come and just lay things down. Pray that God will open your eyes. Maybe you're even blinded to what's going on, that you don't get a sense that you've lost this freedom. Maybe you've never experienced this freedom. You've experienced salvation, but maybe not gospel freedom. If you haven't experienced it, it's amazing. And if we could just get to a point where we'll focus on him, rely on him, what a great place to be. So as we move to this time of response, my ask of you is that you be obedient in however God leads you. Whether it's to pray at your seat, whether it's to come up here and pray, I'll be up here if you'd like to pray. Or maybe you just want to write something to us. Let us know what you're going through so that we can pray for you. Those cards and the chairs around you, write one of the, fill one of those out for us. We're not to walk this alone. We're free, but we're free together. When we stand firm, we don't do it by ourselves. We do it together. This is the time. This is the place to experience that freedom and take it with you as you go. Let's stand together as the team comes to lead us in our song of response. Father God, once again, we thank you for this opportunity to look at your word, to see what Paul is teaching these Galatians. And Father, I pray that you would help us to see maybe where we need to exercise some of these things that Paul has mentioned. Father, help us to ask you to guide us in this, to reveal to us, to open our eyes to maybe things in our lives that we need to lay down before you, that we need to give to you completely. God, so often we can take steps back in our faith. And Father, it's hard to come back to you. But we know you're always there. We know you're always waiting, ready for us. So God, allow us to walk in obedience this morning as we seek to honor you and glorify you with our lives. So God, in this time that's to come right now, as we respond, we pray that you would be glorified and honored. We ask this in Jesus' name.
Come home.
This time we're going to pause for a moment of giving as an act of worship. I'm going to ask the ushers if they would bring the plates forward. And as they do, this will be an opportunity during this next song to bring your offerings and tithes forward. Also, if you filled out one of those cards and you want to offer your life today, you can bring that forward at this time. You can also do that as you come and go at the back, whatever you prefer. But let's take a moment. Let's pray as they bring the plates forward. Father God, once again, we praise you for the opportunity to worship you, the freedom that we do have to just publicly recognize you as our Lord and Savior and as our God. And so, Father, we thank you that you've given us that ability. We thank you that we are free in Christ to live that way. Father, now as we turn to this time of worship through giving, I pray that you would help us to give with hearts that are the proper attitude and mindset. Father, that you would help us to give expecting you to do more with this than we could on our own, expecting you to bring yourself glory as you further your kingdom. So God, we pray that you would again find us obedient as we follow you in this and follow your example of what it looks like to give. We ask this in Jesus' name. You guys can have a seat for just a moment. A few announcements to walk through. today we do have youth. That's the only change, though, is we're not meeting here. We'll be meeting up at Greenville University. The youth worship night starts at 6. I'll be up there by 5:30, so anytime after that, you can drop the kids up there. We'll be done about 7:15 or so. A couple more announcements for the ladies. Ladies Bible study is going to be starting back up Tuesday, April 23rd and 30th. These do not necessarily build on each other. They're kind of standalone studies, so if you've not been before, don't let that hold you back from joining in for these 2 weeks of it. There's more information on that table in the back and a sign-up sheet back there as well. Ladies' lunch and axe throwing Saturday, April 27th at 11. Again, more information and sign-up is back in Fellowship Hall if you'd like to be part of that. Or you can ask Tammy Wrench, Debbie Riddle, I think, have details on that as well. Those who attended our membership class that we had back in January, February, we've set the date of April 28th after second service for the dinner. So please let us know if you can attend. Don't shake your head at me. Well, of course you can't. Terry, you can come, though, okay? You just leave Sandy at home. Taking him with you, huh? Well, if you can attend, let us know. Text me, call the office, or fill out one of those cards for us. We'd love to have you and host you for that event. Then I've got a card here. It says, Dear Smith Grove family, I believe things don't just happen, but that everything happens for a reason and that God is in control of everything in our lives. Terry and I have felt your prayers through this ordeal, and God must have a plan for us yet. We thank you so much for all your prayers, cards, gift cards, kind words, and thoughts while I was in the hospital and had surgery. We really appreciate it all. You are all a blessing to me and Terry. May God bless you all with love, Jerry and Terry File. Thank you all so much. And so continue to pray for Jerry as he recovers, but he's getting along pretty well. The other one I want to update you on is Peggy Reed is home from the long-term care over in Alhambra. And Susan's taken off some time to help. And if you would like to help with Peggy or can have some time to go sit so Susan can run errands and stuff periodically, please let me know and I will get your information to Susan. We're just trying to get some people together so that she has some she can call on to come and help her out in these next few weeks as Peggy still recovers. From her ordeal as well. All right, let's stand together, and before we go, let's say the Great Commission. And Jesus came and said to them,
All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son.
And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. Go out with him today.